everybody.
Hey, everybody.
Hello.
This is Sexy Nerd Science, Season 3, Episode 5.
Episode 5.
We always do that. So we've got a pretty good show for you today. We've got a special guest on here. We'll introduce him in a second. Got a couple quick news. We don't really have anything planned out to say as far as news-wise.
I'm not that special, Josh.
Oh, and Dale's here too, I guess. Dale's always like in the background listening. Let's all take an appreciation that Dale's probably listening to you right now while you're listening to this podcast.
I don't know necessarily if like Dale gets guest status anymore. Like he can't
be, I don't think so either.
Like you just have to say something, Dale. You can't just be quiet because then you're part of this.
Hey everybody.
There we go. He's on the website. I mean, like his silhouette is on the website. Like I don't know how
he'll just have
it. Yeah. But let's go ahead and we will introduce our sexy nerd of the month, comic book writer and just all around nice guy, Louise. Louise, do you mind introducing yourself to the fans here?
I am Louis Cruz, and I'm the creator and writer of Jennifer the She-Wolf and Bloodkill and Fuel of Life, and the publisher of Cruzin Comics. And I'm from New York, the Bronx particularly, and anything else you can ask.
We plan on it.
Yes,
we definitely will. We'll get there. Sexy news today. We do within sexy news. You know, obviously, it is not necessarily the lighthearted stuff that we get to typically, but we do always honor you know, the fallen in the sexy news. So, Dale, you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, this past weekend. One of the Detroit greats, Mike Illich Sr., passed away. He owned the Detroit Red Wings and also the Detroit Tigers, Little Caesars Pizza, pretty much a lot of big name companies, in Detroit. And, he passed away. He was not doing so well over the past few years. So that did happen. It was pretty cool though, because in front of Comerica Park, which is the Tiger Stadium, they had a big wall with people wrote their names on, had little messages goodbye. There was a article of that online, which I thought was a good touch for the city to remember a guy that pretty much built half of Detroit, at least in this past few years. So I thought that was pretty cool. So goodbye, Mr. Illich.
Also, just kind of briefly about that, something that I remember reading. I mean, not only was he a business owner in Detroit, but he was also like a pretty big philanthropist. I believe didn't he help out, because Rosa Parks, for those that don't know, ended up moving from Montgomery to Detroit, Michigan, and lived there throughout the rest of her life. And I believe, didn't Mike Illich like pay for her rent for like a year or something like that? I thought it was a pretty big like gesture that he made to kind of help her out while she was in town. I just can't quite remember what it was. I don't know if Dale, you know more about that.
No, honestly, I didn't hear that story before. I knew Rosa Parks moved here, but besides anything else, no, I didn't know anything about that.
Well, we could Google it, everybody. So everyone's just... from what I hear, he's just a huge part of Michigan and especially the Detroit recovery. A lot of the stuff he was doing was making sure to bring back business and people back to the city to make sure that they can continue building Detroit back up. So it's got a special place. Detroit's our home away from Omaha here, so.
And like a hop, skip, and a jump away from Dale. So,
yeah. Further away from the Bronx, though. So, moving on from that, I don't know. Do we have any other things in sexy news we want to address?
Sexy news. I think there was, I mean, you want to do a couple, any open movie trailers that we talked about or that we want to talk about? Anything anybody saw?
I honestly just saw like a new Logan trailer, and it didn't seem like it had any new scenes in it as much as it did like just like new music montage for scenes from Logan.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. Yeah, I don't think I have anything else.
What do you think about the Logan trailer, though? I'm curious.
I thought the first Logan trailer, I think it was with the Johnny Cash music, blew all the other trailers out of the water. I think the music mixed with the actual fast-paced movement of it was fantastic. Any of the other ones, they're fine. They're good representation of what the movie will be about. But overall, I thought the first one that they came out with was the best.
I think it's wise, though, to call it Logan instead of like the other two was called Wolverines, you know, so.
Well, I think you or Drew would know more about this, but I think the storyline is based on Old Man Logan. So, I mean, I think they were kind of going for that theme and not like a Wolverine or X-Men type of situation.
So, in my non-professional but comic book reading opinion, they, with the three Wolverine movies that they did, they touched on three separate comic lines of Wolverines. They touched on the Old Man Logan, which is the new one. They touched on, I can't remember what the story arc is, but the Shanghai one.
Samurai one.
Yeah, the Samurai one, where he's in Shanghai. And then they touched on, obviously, the origin story of Wolverine.
Samurais aren't in Shanghai, just FYI for everybody.
I think the arc is supposed to be something that has to deal with, I think that's in the name of the arc, if I remember correctly, but it's been a while. Or maybe that's a completely different story arc.
Wasn't he like the Silver Samurai or something was the villain in that, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And he's the Adamantium Samurai, essentially. Yeah. But it was Japan. And you find out, like, you get the Nagasaki backstory and stuff in that, too, mm-hmm. as well.
And you know all these areas because of, you know, Wolverine's background in the origin story. They have him going through, you know, you see bits of him in all these different wars and stuff with him and Sabretooth being side by side through almost all those little flashbacks scenes in the origin story movie. But back to the trailer, I personally like this last trailer just because it gives you a little bit of I can't remember her name. I'm drawing a blank on it now. The girl's actual powers.
The female Wolverine.
Yeah, I can't remember her the kid.
I don't remember my name either. I know in the books she's now being called the Wolverine.
Luis, what's your take on the trailers?
I'm not a fan of it. I'm really not a fan of it, only because it's they're gonna touch base. I think to me they're gonna touch on the death of Wolverine, and I always thought that was a big mistake to kill off a big famous character like that, even in the books. And I'm not familiar with the Old Man Logan storyline because, to me, Wolverine, when I was growing up, never aged. He was one of those characters that would be around for a long, long time. I remember reading a Guardians of the Galaxy back when Jim Valentino wrote it, where they actually had his skeletal bone because his skin hadn't generated no more, and it was in a test tube, and like a long one of those cylinder see-through with water and everything breathing. And I thought that was crazy because it's in the future, but they have his skeletal body there, you know.
Yeah, that's interesting. I've never heard that before.
The old book.
I mean, this is gonna play music. Sorry, guys. Sorry, I had to close that out. Anyway, the character for Laura Keeney is her the character's name. I think she'll be, I just had to look it up here. I think she'll do well in the role. But to touch on the Wolverine never aging, he does,
it's at a slow accelerated rate.
Huh?
It's at a slow accelerated rate.
Yeah, it's a very, very minuscule amount. So that way, I mean, you can imagine how much time has passed at that point. And I think that's kind of, you know, everything is decimated by the point he's, you know, you were watching Old Man Logan, everybody's, you know, they're like, you know, the last mutants, and they're going through that whole struggle there, and he's lost the will to fight basically. And he comes back with a little bit of vengeance, you know, and Laura Kinney helps him out with that. So
I think they got the female Wolverine, they got her to be too young. She should have been more of a teenager actress. She should have been a little older. And I love the fact that the character Wolverine has been in every mutant movie from the beginning, in every movie, even as a cameo. And I thought that was cool.
I actually like her age, the new Wolverine's age. And the reason I do that is because movies today get over-sexualized. And I think that, excuse me, as a younger character, maybe she's, like you said, too young, but I think she pulls off the role, just based on the trailers, pretty good. She focuses on the serious aspects of it. I think it's well done as far as only the trailers, what I saw. But I think, like I said, it over-sexualizes the character, and I think that's not what they're going for. They're trying to go for that broken down, you know, they're focusing on Logan's storyline, and then her, you know, giving him the strength to, you know, continue on one more fight, in my opinion. Well, we'll find out.
Yeah, two things I was going to say real quick. First, touching on Dale's point about the young actress, I definitely, like, make sure everyone, you're not writing off the age of the actress, because we all saw how awesome Hit Girl turned out to be from Kick-Ass. And I mean, that actress has gone on to basically, I mean, her roles going forward now, she could always be in an action role like that again. Simply because, I mean, she was such a young girl when she did that. I think she was like 13, 14 when she played Hit Girl the first time. So that's fantastic. And two, I don't know if I'm missing it, because I'm not familiar with the Logan storyline either, but did I see adamantium claws in the young girl Wolverine as well? Because that was surprising for me, because A, where did they get the adamantium? B.
So the bit about Wolverine is that he is part animal. And with that, he gets the rapid healing factor, because he's mutated, not only with the rapid healing factor, but because he's part animal. And so the whole shtick is there can be others like him. The X-23 in the origin, I think is the origin story, where she had the five fingernails that came out, and she was able to slice and dice with the fingernails. That was, you know, the same type of mutation, quote unquote. But, you know, instead of the claws, she had the nail. They're cat claws, not whatever we would call Wolverine's claws. Knuckle claws, knuckles. That's her mutation. At the point where she gets the adamantium, though, is where I also lose, you know, where that happened. I'm not 100% familiar with the story arc enough to know that much, but I'm very excited to see how they play her, because, like I said, she is young. Like Josh said, doesn't mean we can't write them off yet, but you know, with that, you know, maybe they'll tone down somebody trying to obviously somebody's going to say something about it, but you know, we don't necessarily condone that. So
I remember reading somewhere that I think she's in the storyline, she was a clone of his. So I don't know if they're going to play that off or an actual daughter, but I know that she, in the storyline that I read when I was young, that she was a clone.
And I thought clone too, but I would have assumed that if you cloned Wolverine, you'd get bone claws and rapid healing, not adamantium claws and rapid healing. Because, I mean, Stryker, you know, was the one who found the adamantium, melted it down, and you can only melt it once, apparently, and then used that on Wolverine, and then kept it still boiling. And then years later, as they were perfecting it, obviously, yes, I hate it, but X-Men Origins used the adamantium for Wade Wilson, used leftover adamantium for the girl with cat claws. And then when she got killed, like all the adamantium was used up. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was kind of curious as to where they were going to get more from in the storyline.
Well, the Wikipedia thing right here says X-23, which is the character we're talking about, is a clone daughter of Wolverine. She has everything that he has except adamantium-coated bone claws, same as he does, in her hands and feet. And then she's supposed to succeed Wolverine as the new Wolverine. So it's from a damaged copy of a Wolverine genome, is what I'm being told, or what I'm reading.
Okay.
So
maybe the adamantium fused with Wolverine on a, like, cellular level. So they were able to, you know, when they cloned the genes, that went forward on there. But let's get off Wolverine for right now. Seeing as, I mean, I know Louise seems to be pretty calm with this, but you know, we're here for him, and I want to talk more about what he has to say about different topics. And I just want the people listening to this to hear more about our Sexy Nerd of the Month. So, do you guys mind if we just move on right into Nerd of the Month here?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. So first thing, I got a question I was thinking about right off the bat here. So one of the things that we talked about before this is that, you know, so people that aren't watching us on YouTube here, you can't even really tell, but Louise has a disability that he is working with his comics, and, you know, has that there. From what he's talked to me about, it both aids as a reference tool for different characters and stuff like that, but could also be something that might hinder his ability. And we were talking about this, and I just want to know, Louise, how has your disability, if we want to call it that, how has that affected you and your comic work writing?
I don't think it affected it. I've pretty much had the same struggle as anybody else trying to get in the business would. My disability has allowed me to actually maybe get a couple of doors open. I remember graduating high school, and a friend of mine told me he's going to take me to the DC comic book building. And I met, at the time, I didn't know that he was that popular because I wasn't into comics like that. Dennis O'Neill, who looked at my work and looked at my drawings and basically told me that comic book drawing for me is a no-go because I take too long my drawings to write my mouth. I write, draw, and type with my mouth. He told me to stick to the writing, that my storytelling was stronger than my art. And that's what made me do the writing part, but I didn't know how to break into comics. Until I got hired by a publisher, maybe an independent publisher, about maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and I learned from them. And in terms of the disability, I think it opened up a couple of doors instead of closing. I mean, I've met the editor to Valiant, who told me to get my name established, better off to start my own thing, you know. And the disability part really shouldn't hinder anybody from getting anything they want to accomplish. If they see it, go for it. You know, it's the word disability is only given to people who don't understand what we do, how we do it. And that's just my opinion.
You know? Cool. Yeah.
Pretty much it, you know.
You talked about you do you do a lot of the writing yourself. You started your own publishing company, correct?
Yeah, my own little label, yeah.
Yep. And that's Cruzin Comics. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's pretty cool.
The reason why I called it that is because my last name is Cruz, and I roll around in a wheelchair, so I figured, why not, you know? Why not call it Cruzin Comics? I'm always cruising around, you know what I'm saying?
Good play on words.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was going to say, that's very, very clever, you know.
Thank you.
And it actually sounds pretty catchy. If you do pick up a copy of any of Louise's stuff here, the title moniker up in the top left corner looks to be a wheelchair wheel on fire.
I originally wanted to use the handicap symbol, but I was afraid I was going to get in trouble for that.
Start moving.
I don't know if, I mean, maybe it's copyrighted. I don't know.
Yeah, the ADA, the American Disability
Act. Everything's copyrighted.
Right.
Pretty much, yeah.
But except
their Sexy Nerd Science logo.
No, don't say that. It is copyrighted. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Don't be so transparent, Josh.
Yeah. Your first comic, Luis, was Jennifer the She-Wolf. Was that correct?
Yes. Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Jennifer the She-Wolf is about a female in the 1920s who was on her way home with her husband at the time. And they come across this creature eating at a body that at first they thought it was a wild animal eating at a deer or something. Upon closer look, it was a werewolf who killed her husband, bites her. And basically when she wakes up, he tells her that she won't be able to go back to her two kids, which that's where they were going. And she will now be part of his little group. And the story jumps from the 1920s to 2014. And it picks up from there where she fights these zombies where it was created in, you're gonna find out that it was created by the Steingards, which are clones of Frankenstein's monster. And he calls himself Franklin, because he's a clone of the original Frankenstein. And what she doesn't know is that, what Jennifer doesn't know is that her daughter survived by becoming a vampire against her will. But she doesn't know she's alive, and the daughter doesn't know that the mother's alive. So she had two kids that she was going home to, which was the daughter and the son. And the daughter actually had to kill the son, the brother and the daughter, I mean, and the aunt to survive because she wasn't trained how to be a vampire. So she'll resent her mother for that. And she'll meet this, Jennifer becomes friends with this guy in a wheelchair, hint, hint, who actually sees what Jennifer can become, which is a werewolf. And the question is asked, can you make me into what you are? Because if you make me into what you are, I might have the possibility of walking. She explains to him that it's not a blessing, it's a curse to be what she is. He's willing to take the chance. He is willing to take the chance to go as far as it has to. And the daughter, once she finds out that that's her mother, the question is asked, why is it that you could become his friend, care for him, but you couldn't come back to me? So she'll wind up taking that young man. And the question is, will she make him a vampire or will he become a wolf? But in all my stories, I like to add somebody with a disability, because I don't think Professor X is the only one that should be in a comic book with a disability.
Cool.
I actually had a question about that. I know I don't want to take away from Drew, because I know Drew's got another question. Assuming. But I, because you mentioned that, I needed to ask, is there a favorite character of yours, like that in like one of the modern comics that does have a disability? Because I was thinking in my head, I'm like, how many can I think of? And I didn't even think about Professor X, but I definitely thought of Oracle mm-hmm. from the Batman comics.
Yes.
And that was something that
one of the people is in a wheelchair in Shazam, the Shazam kids as well.
That might be Oracle too.
Oh, maybe. I don't know.
I'm not quite sure. But
characters that I noticed with Marvel and DC that put these people in wheelchairs, they're not born. The Professor X wasn't born handicapped. Oracle wasn't born handicapped. You know, it's. I get it what they're trying to do, but have a reason. Have them be born handicapped. You know, have them, you know, do something that they're born like that, and have them strive for something, other than give them a mutant power or something. You know.
Yeah, I like that in your comics you do that. You know, you give people those that, you know, you wanted something in comics and then you went out and you did it yourself. So now other people can now reference you for having done that in your comics. So I like that's the be the change that you want to see in the world kind of attitude there. And that's pretty awesome. So sorry, I didn't mean to skip my turn here, but...
No, you're fine.
Thank you.
No, so I had a couple questions. One was going to be the Oracle / Barbara Gordon, which no harm, no foul there with Josh asking. Now, do you believe that Daredevil was born with his disability?
Do I believe? Could you repeat that?
Daredevil was born with his disability?
No, Daredevil wasn't. No, that was an accident with his eyes. Also,
wasn't it chemicals got splashed in it?
Yeah, I thought that's what made him have the ability, but I thought he was always blind.
I don't think he has any abilities. I think it's just a.
He can see like silhouettes, like he wasn't born with the blindness. I don't think.
Then disregard.
I don't think he was born blind.
That's, I mean, now that I'm thinking about it, like, I can't think of a single character that I know of that was born with a disability. I mean, X-Men that are just like have like genetic mutations that we might consider something like that, but I mean, it's which brings up another question later on down the line. Because I know we talked about this too when you were talking about the cure for the X-Men cure versus a handicap cure and how those two can correlate with one of your books. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I can't think of one off the top of my head. And I Dale's, I guess, trying to Google it. I don't know if he's had any success at all.
Oh, I found it. I said, Shazam, it was Billy Batson. He, you know, gets... magical powers from a wizard and becomes Captain Marvel or Shazam, whatever you want to call it. However, in Flashpoint, the alternate version of the Justice League, Shazam the wizard gives powers to all the kids of the, I believe it's an orphanage or a group home or something. And one of the kids actually has a disability. I can't find what his disability is, but he actually has to walk with arm braces, the ones that with the you hold down to the lever and you have to walk it's like crutches, but more of the permanent ones that you have to walk with. There's a second storyline. He becomes Captain Captain Thunder. All the kids just join up to become him. And then he also becomes Shazam Jr.
It's like Captain Planet, or with your powers combined, we become Captain Thunder.
Yeah. Similar.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
How's that?
They have rings and all. No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, so that's one I knew of off the top of my head, but I looked for that one. But yeah, you're right about not as many disabilities in comic book world as maybe there should be.
And it's not only, I feel that it's not only comic books, but even TV. I mean, there's one show now, I believe, that has a kid in a wheelchair. I forget the name of the show, but I feel that, you know, people with disabilities are people too, and we do things similar to you guys, you know, to you, not you guys, but physically normal people. And again, what the word normal or physically or disabled, what is the actual meaning of it? Because I'm physically disabled, but my mind is, you know, it's functioning well. So I have this theory where I believe that normal people are the ones that are handicapped. Because if you line up 10 physically normal people and you ask them how they write, they will say either with their right or their left arms. You line up 10 handicapped people and you ask them how they write. Some of us write with our mouths, like me. Some write with their feet. Some write with a helmet with a pen attached to it. So who exactly is the handicapped one? You for doing everything the same or us for being different? And that's just my thing.
Yeah, it's a different way to look at it, definitely.
I love this. Like this is the greatest, like, no offense to any guests we've had before, but I mean, like, this is one of my favorite, like, guests. Like, everything you say, just, I know we mentioned it earlier, you know, the Workout Wednesdays thing, but like everything you say is so positive, and I love the twist you put on things. And I know, I mean, we've had people that, you know, that are transgender on the podcast. We've had people that do, you know, not the normal things. And I know, like, people always say, you know, I'm not the spokesperson, I don't speak for everybody, but it's just so refreshing to hear something like this. Like, I love it. And this is what makes me really happy to, like, every time to do the podcast, something like this, a story like this, just, I love it. So, Louise, I know we're like halfway through, but I'm already saying thank you for being on the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. This is just, yeah, I love it. And I want to, while we're kind of thinking here, I want to think of more questions to ask. Do you want to talk about one of your other works that you have that you want to talk about on the podcast here? So maybe someone else listening might want to pick up one of those.
I have The Blood Kill. It's about a police officer who actually gets shot. And it's the Blood Kill spirit is forced onto him, but the body of that of the spirit has been roaming the world for 2,000 years looking for his spirit, and they're gonna meet. And in the opening pages of Blood Kill, the cop is interviewing a young lady who was nearly raped by these three thugs that Blood Kill saved. But at the end, the police officer kind of asks himself, "I thought I was Blood Kill. You know, who is this other guy calling himself Blood Kill?" He doesn't know that. The body is looking for its spirit, you know. And then another story I have is called Fuel of Life, and I wrote that as a short illustrated story. It's basically asks the question, what if our blood was used for fuel on an alien vessel? We call those aliens vampires, but that's just because we didn't understand them, and our blood is their fuel to escape, you know. And those are the two that I have out there right now. And I'm trying to create another one called Crippled Earth, which is basically what if there's a parallel universe where the people there are all physically disabled, but they do everything like everybody else here. They've got construction workers and everything, but an alien race makes contact with them, but they come to find out that alien race is actually physically normal people who have a cure for the disabilities that are there. How would the people of the parallel world react? Would they think that the cure is a mutation? How would they react to people who took it? Would they treat them as outcasts? You know, it's kind of like a X-Files meets, X-Files meets something else.
Weird. It's like X-Men, X-Files,
yeah.
Like the X series.
I was going to say it's like an X crossover.
Yeah.
An X-over. So with that, I know that you said that that's kind of in its infancy, correct?
Yes, that's basically got an outline, and I'm trying to see if I want to make it into a comic book or a kind of like a novel type thing.
So with that, would you go more so of like a...
You know, I've even written an erotic story from a handicapped point of view, and it's online, actually. And that's gotten pretty good hits, yeah. I've gotten hits from the UK for that, yeah.
But real quick, I had a question about the, we'll come back to that. Cause I mean, obviously that's interesting to
it is.
I knew Dale would like that. But real quick, do you think, and like, when you think about the cure, do you think it's a cure all, or do you think that they have an understanding of specific, you know, or like of the varying disabilities, and there's different cures to that? To those, or do they just have the one magical serum that kind of?
No, it's going to be a process. Like, they'll be able to cure one, like, for example, I have arthrogryposis. So let's say they'll be able to cure everybody who has arthrogryposis in the beginning. And then they have maybe one or two cures for certain diseases. And then the rest will come out of the cures that they've given to people. Like it'll
there'll be different iterations.
It'll mute.
So like within curing one person, that will show up a different iteration of a cure for.
Right.
That's I think that's interesting. I was just kind of curious about how you thought that cure would manifest itself. Yeah, so back to this erotica. What's the premise you said from a
it's basically telling the story of these two people who meet at a job, and the opening line, I don't know if I'm allowed to say here, but it's kind of vulgar, and they're both sitting there and they work. She's actually a supervisor, and the question, she's so curious about the guy in the wheelchair that she'll ask, does everything work, but in a more grown-up way, you know, does everything work, and she'll basically get to try it. Ride the wheelchair and all.
Wow, ride the wheelchair and all. That's fantastic.
Talk about cruising.
And there's our episode title.
So you said that's gotten a lot of hits in the UK. What's the title of that one, Freddy?
What is it called? It's called The Workout, Erotica from a Handicap's Point of View.
And so I noticed that the other Jennifer the She-Wolf and then the other two are available on IndiePlanet.us, correct?
Yes.
I've seen that for a purchase price. And I was going to say, I was able to read the first three pages. And so I kind of knew a little bit of the initial pages for Jennifer She-Wolf, how you said that, you know, it starts off in the 20s. But there's like the dollar price points on those are fairly inexpensive. So those should be pretty easy to pick up there. Is the one that the erotica, is that available at a price point as well, or is that
that's on Amazon? It's only, I believe, it's 99 cents, you know. And I'm planning on making that the artist I work with, he gave me the idea to do it like The Fuel of Life, which is like a short illustrated book where it has you know, prose on one side and image on the other with every page you turn. He told me let's try doing that with the erotic story. So
yeah, that's what I was going to kind of say, is maybe do kind of like more so like a graphic novel of sorts.
Yeah.
How you were talking about Crippled Earth being you know, thrown out the idea to have either a graphic novel or not a novel or a comic style. So do you have anything else, even like in its infancy, that you would want to tell us about? But I mean,
I have a character called Target. He's basically, and again, this is where I like to put things in the mix, touched with reality. Target is a black ops operative who she basically becomes a merc for hire because her sister got into a real bad car accident and died, but her niece is alive, but needs to be put in basically a breathing machine to keep her alive. And that can add up to be quite expensive even for a military person. So she does the black ops thing and she'll get framed. Think of Punisher, but with more of a, instead of where Frank Castle's family died or whatever, this one she has to keep her niece alive, you know, and there's gonna be some trouble where she's gonna wind up meeting and working for this cartel who actually, you know, basically tries to hold that against her, you know, her own niece against her, you know. So that's something that's in its infancy as well. It's basically got maybe 3 to 5 scripted pages and some character designs out there.
Very nice. I was like to see the you know, badass female mercenary type characters that don't take no shit and everything. So it's part of, you know, part of the whole, the quality in characters and comic books and stuff. So
thank you.
So Louise, before we were recording here for the podcast, we were talking earlier about, you know, you're born on 25th of December, and I made the joke, you know, God's gift.
Yeah.
And we were talking about there, you said there was an accident when you were a child, and you kind of walked away with a miracle. I mean, literally in that sense, walked away with a miracle. Literally, and has that, I mean, has that life experience, or have there any been other life experiences that you've had that have like influenced your writing? Because honestly, what that sounds like to me is a lot like that comic you were describing of, you know, where the boy finds out, you know, by some miracle that the rainbow lands down, and then, oh my goodness, like you're actually from this world where everything's fine and you can walk and you're no longer, you know, you don't have the handicap anymore, and you have to choose between which side of the fence to be on, you know, which side of the rainbow to be on. I was just wondering if anything in your personal life has, I mean, of course it has, but if you have any examples where things in your personal life have affected a story that you've written or are thinking about writing.
The rainbow story, that's very, very close to me, because in the beginning I wrote basically of the stuff they told my mother when I was born, that, you know, I wouldn't amount to anything, like they should leave me in the hospital and this, that, and the other. So I took that into the first half of the chapter, and how the doctor stated that, you know, I basically put my mother and my father in there with different names and how they reacted to it in terms of having a handicapped child as their firstborn. You have to keep in mind that in the 70s, yes, I'm aging myself right now. In the 70s, when handicaps were born, not too many parents stuck around with them. My parents did. You know, my mother was 20, is 20 years older than me. My father was 17 years older than me. So they were pretty young when they had me. And to stick with me, it's proof on its own that they actually, I guess, saw something, you know, other than just a guy in a wheelchair or a guy that would be handicapped. You know, my father would feel bad because I couldn't do everything my brothers did. But my brothers aren't writers like me. My brothers aren't, like I used to get mad when I was young. The one thing I always felt that I always wanted to do was feel the crack of a bat in my hand hitting a baseball. But then I started thinking, baseballs hit you, you know, by mistake, and I don't want that. And the one sport I don't understand, and you might think this is weird, football. Why would you want to catch a ball and have 30 guys chase you trying to put you in a wheelchair? I don't understand that. I mean, this, I don't understand that. I mean, it's, from a handicapped point of view, it's not a cool sport.
Are you a Jets fan? Is that why you hate football? Or
actually, I'm not a football fan at all. No,
just kidding.
No, not a football fan.
Yeah. So,
yeah. I again, like I said, I have to applaud that answer. I think that it makes me just curious. Like, I want to, you know, like I said, I'm not a big comic guy, but I want to go out. I want to read these stories. I want to get those kind of feelings. I want to know like your life experiences through these comic books. And I just like, I think it's awesome that you've taken something that's happened to you and it doesn't bother you. You know, like it's like you said in the beginning, like it's not something that bothers you because it's not something that defines you. You know, you're still a great artist. You've overcome many obstacles. And I mean, I love it. So
thank you. My agent says I would be, if anything ever kicks off big, that it would be an inspirational story to be told later on. Because even when I go to Comic Cons, I don't see too many handicapped people sitting behind a table doing signatures. You know, doing what I do, I don't see too many handicaps doing it for some reason. I've never encountered that. And I'm hoping that changes, because we're out there.
Yeah, I mean, you know, how I know that you've been to a couple around us, right, guys?
No, I everything is New York.
New York?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, you said, I think we talked about it briefly. You said, did you go to Planet Comic Con before?
No, I said I've heard of it.
Oh, okay, gotcha, gotcha.
Yeah.
Were you here in Omaha at one point in time, I thought, or no?
No.
Mm-mm. I could have sworn, because I mean, I remember, because I brought up this interview with Iggy, and even Iggy from Project Nerd, like, he's familiar with Cruzin Comics, like, he's familiar with your name and your brand. So I thought there was some overlap we had there at one point in time. So now I'm kind of curious, how'd you hear about our podcast?
I saw it on Twitter, and I think I bumped into
Twitter.
No, the what's that other thing you told me about? The nerd, Project Nerd.
Project Nerd.
Yep.
Yeah, and that's how I bumped into you guys.
Awesome. Okay. So, what is your it's like plans for the con circuit for you? Are you like, where are you heading to?
I'm gonna be in Yonkers, hopefully. I believe it's May. It's not set in it's not set in stone yet. Doing a it's kind of like a children's con. And I'll be there doing signings, and I'm hoping to have an exclusive either poster or maybe the first 5 or 8 pages to issue number 2 of Jennifer She-Wolf. Hopefully, you know.
Yeah. Very cool. Very cool.
Do you have anything in the works for a younger crowd? Or any thoughts on anything for a younger crowd? Because I know that that's another good avenue.
One of the stories I wrote, and I work with children, so everything I write, I give it to my kids to read to get feedback. And one of the things that
except the erotica.
Except that one. Yes. That one I gave it to my boss. Like, I gave them I wrote a story based on the actual place that I work at. It's a community center. And I wrote it where this there's a Halloween party, but nobody's there yet. These 3 kids come early, and they encounter this clown, which they think is a staff. Come to find out the clown is not a staff, and they go through the hallway, and they get scared of certain things. And it's not really developed. It's just like loosely written. It's maybe 11 pages long, 12 pages long. I wrote it as a real short story with a beginning, middle, and end. And the kids seem to like it. They want me to expand on it, but I haven't really sat down to do that. That's where I'm at right now in terms of the younger crowd.
That's interesting. I mean, even having something, a baseline for something like that is not even anywhere that any of us are close to. So, but we commend that creativity and everything for sure. Which is part of the biggest, the feature that we thought kind of we lacked in our first season was a creator aspect. We had cosplayers, some of whom made their own cosplays, but mostly we did it just because of, the look of a cosplay or anything like that. But more recently we've had, creators who do, just like yourself, who are writing, do drawings and then, book, people have had published books or self-published books. So creators are, we're trying to get creators in our wheelhouse at this point in time, and we're glad to have you on and everything. Do we have anything else you want to do? Question of the week.
I just want to mention that I've been lucky to have the artists that I have working on my books. I mean, I'm doing the writing and the creating, and I'll sketch something out or whatever. But the art team for Bloodkill they're from Spain, and I reached out to them through the social networks. And with the Bloodkill and the Fuel of Life were done by an artist who calls himself Amarty, and his name is Angel Maria Martinez. And the guy that did Jennifer the She-Wolf is two of them, one from New York called Miguel Angel, and the other is Henry Simon. Those are my two collaborators here. And I have a letterer who's Jorge Medina, who actually publishes his own stuff with Mass Media Studios. So it's kind of like cool when you get to work with other people who are, you know, give you this feedback back and forth in terms of like, when I write something, they'll get back to me like, no, you should change it like this. It makes it sound better. You know, it's interesting when you get this creative feedback going back and forth, you know, and I guess like you guys, when you guys do your podcast, you bounce off each other's conversations and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah. And that's something that we kind of learned also from, you know, Project Nerd podcast, and when they were actively doing weekly shows, you know, they were kind of our mentors in that aspect. But we additionally, the three of us always, you know, bounce off each other as well. So, but yeah, that's another thing I didn't think about with, you know, having a secondary publisher, but from Spain, that's awesome.
Yeah, they Henry Simon and Angel Maria Martinez are from Spain.
That's you said you would just reach out to them from social media, and they.
Yeah, well, Henry Simon, it was from a previous publisher who closed their doors, and he worked on one of my books that I was writing. He was doing the second part, and Angel was also part of that, but I've never worked with him, and I just decided to ask him, "You want to jump on Cruzin Comics?"
Nice.
And that's... Miguel Angel, who's from here, from the Bronx. He has Mythography Comics, which his stories deal with the Puerto Rican culture heroes. Very cool concept there.
I can't imagine trying to even put something like that together. I can't even barely pay my phone bill. But I guess we do have a podcast, and we got that sort of, you know, following and everything, and it allows us to, you know, meet with people, you know, who do their own thing like you. And, you know, that's part of what we love about this. You know, I'm fairly certain I speak for all of us when we, you know, are able to speak with creators, cosplayers, people who we otherwise probably would never have spoken with, you know, in these aspects. But of course, you know, like I said, I think Dale's probably got something in the works for putting links on the website and everything, I'm sure.
Oh, definitely.
For the comics, especially make sure you put the erotica in big, bold letters.
Oh, yeah, definitely. big image of it, too.
Yeah. But, yeah, so available on Amazon for the erotica, and then...
So is Bloodkill and
Bloodkill.
The Fuel of Life is available on Indie Planet and Amazon.
Okay, Indie Planet. Yep.
And I'll also have all the links for everything, for if you want to purchase something on the Indie Planet or on Amazon. Also with the Cruzin Planet, Cruzin Comics. I'm sorry, on Indie Planet. Just a little description of that.
As well. Hey, what makes you more money? Is it Amazon, or we'll just post the one link?
Both about equal.
Quick like question.
I was telling Dale earlier that a lot of the money that's made is actually, you get it off of cons, really. These digital things is just to get your name out there, but the cons is where you make a nice little profit.
Nice. What's your expected turnaround time for shipping? Do you ship out or do?
No. For example, Indie Planet does it when you order it. Nice. You can. Indie Planet is the only one where you can actually order a hard copy or a digital copy.
Nice.
Yeah. One thing I was going to say is I like this podcast, like this specific one, so much that when we apply for like press badges and stuff, I'm going to be probably linking them to this podcast. For different conventions and stuff around the US, if they hear this, you know, interview, they hear the stuff you do, and they want to have you come out as a comic book guest, you know, or if you can come out as a comic book guest, are there ways, like, is there, what works best for you? I mean, do what kind of things do, like, as a comic book, I guess if I were to talk to the guy from O Comic Con and be like, hey, we should get this guy to come out for his comic books. He's a really good comic book artist, like, or a comic book writer. Like, how do we go about doing that?
Or Twitter, Josh. He already said Twitter.
Twitter, or I believe you have my email also. You can actually hit me up on cruisingcomics@yahoo.com. You know, it's one of my emails that I use. And then you guys have my personal one, I believe.
I'm hoping that this, like, can go to someone from, like, Planet Comic-Con or O Comic-Con or anybody that's listened to us from C2E2, and they hear this and they say, hey, Luis Cruz, Cruzin Comics, we definitely want you here. You know, we want you to sell your stuff at our con, and then we could meet you in person one of these times.
That'll be cool.
I've got an electric car. I can drive to New York, I guess, if we need to.
That's cool. I mean, I could go to in my wheelchair, but I would have to leave maybe a week in advance because, you know, it only goes 8 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Well, has somebody, Josh, Dale, do the math on that.
Yeah, so, you know, 8 miles an hour.
3 weeks.
That's about 100 hours.
Yeah, pretty much. And that's without stopping, I'm assuming, for recharging.
Or, oh, you want to stop too? Oh, you can't do that.
I have to recharge, Dale.
Just pull a trailer with more batteries.
I feel like that would defeat the purpose.
It would.
At what point does the drag, or not drag, but you know, towing capacity?
Yeah, it wastes more energy, I think. Yeah.
Well, we'll talk about that science topic next week on the podcast.
So we're gonna wrap up here a little bit, Luis. We do a question of the week every week. Last week's question of the week. Does anybody remember that one? That was
of course. What was your favorite Super Bowl commercial?
That's what it was.
And of course, no one answered.
No one answered. So I guess between the four of us, Luis probably didn't watch. Do you watch the Super Bowl commercials at least?
No, actually, I wasn't even home. I on Sundays I make it my business to go visit my grandmother at the nursing home. So
very nice. Well, I've heard a vast majority of the Super Bowl commercials were very funny. I know there's a couple like YouTube threads of just all the commercials that get played throughout the Super Bowl. So we went through that and watched it. I still am a fan of the Mr. Clean commercial. Got a lot of hits. So that's my pick for the funniest / most entertaining Super Bowl commercial. Josh, Dale?
Dale's? Yeah, I got one. Have you guys seen I think it's oh crap, what is it? I think it's a Geico commercial or some type of insurance commercial. Oh no, it's a health commercial. That's what it is. And what it is Chuck Norris walks into a restaurant and these two guys are thinking, like, is that Chuck Norris? It's like, yeah, that's Chuck Norris. It's like, I bet you if I throw the salt shaker at him, he's gonna catch it. It's like, I bet you you're on. So he throws a salt shaker. Hey, Chuck Norris, and throws it. Chuck Norris does a roundhouse kick, kicks it back, hits him square in the face, and then it falls around the table, you know, standing up straight. And the guy's like, he didn't catch it. You owe me $10 or whatever it was.
That's hilarious.
And it was like really quick, like super, super quick. And I thought that was a good one. So that was my favorite one.
Josh, did you have one?
I still really like the Cam Newton Little League one. Like, I just thought that was so funny watching Cam Newton go against a bunch of little tiny kids playing football. I that's my favorite one still.
Yeah. I think the referee turns into a girl too, doesn't he? Does he? Yeah. Cool. Do you guys get a chance to look at this week's question?
This week's question of the week?
Yeah.
Josh, are you on board with that one?
I like it.
So this week's question of the week, we're going to take it back to our original nerdy topic, or sexy, wherever you want to call it. It was in the beginning of the podcast since we didn't really have a good outline, but is this week's question of the week refers to Laura or X-23. Do we think Logan's X-23 is too young? Do we think the character age, or the actress age, who she's about 11, 12 years old, is too young to play X-23/ Laura Kinney.
We look forward to hearing from you guys.
Yeah. And we will we'll kind of wrap up, and then we'll get Louise's take on that. I mean, I guess he gave us his take. We don't.
It's midnight in the Bronx, man. We gotta get going.
But all right, guys, from all of us here at SexyNerdScience and Cruzin Comics.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening, and we'll see you guys next week.
Thanks for being on.
You guys have a good rest of your week.